Hello and welcome to another episode of Champaign Connection. I'm Rick Atterbury, your host for this inside look at the events and services provided by the City of Champaign. The men and women of the Champaign Police Department interact with the public daily. Sometimes people want to thank them for their service, and sometimes people are concerned about their interactions with police. So today we'll take a look at the newly revamped compliment and complaint process. Plus, not all heroes wear a cape and have superpowers. Find out how ordinary people stepped up in a time of need and provided heroic service to their Champaign neighbors. And the City of Champaign invites everyone to get down and park it. We'll review all the parking options available to downtown visitors, including the beautiful new parking deck. We've got a lot to cover, so put down the remote, settle back, and connect with your community. This episode of Champaign Connection starts now. Our guest is Deputy Police Chief Holly Nearing, and we're talking about complaints and compliments when it comes to the Champaign Police Department. Welcome to the show, Holly.
Thank you very much.
What are some of the situations that police get involved in where the outcome's not going to be pleasant for everybody?
As you might imagine, police get called to a gamut of calls that citizens report to us. Frequently, citizens call us when they have a dispute that they can't resolve themselves with their neighbor or within a house, or they see some sort of tense situation going on outside their house, police are called to come to a resolution of that tense situation. Sometimes the resolution is that police have to take enforcement action or make decisions that make one party or another unhappy. And in those cases, people may feel like the officer's conduct rose to the level that it was inappropriate or not reasonable. In that case, then the citizen is free to come in to the police department, call the police department, or go to various locations to make a complaint against the conduct of an officer.
How often are complaints filed against officers?
We get between 20 and 30 complaints a year, which on the scope of the number of calls we go on is not a high percentage. Of course, we'd like the officers to act professionally in every instance, and the vast majority of time they do. Sometimes a citizen will come in with a complaint that is not necessarily one that we hold that the officer did something wrong. If the officer is acting within policy and acting reasonably, then the complaint may be not sustained. But we do hold our officers to a high standard of professionalism when we ask them to be professional in their interactions with the public. Sometimes officers err and they may say something smart, something they shouldn't have, and in that case, then we hold the officers accountable for their actions.
Now, the police department has been engaged in a study of the complaint process and has changed the way that you're doing some things. What are some of the highlights of the new program?
Every couple of years, we go through a process where the community raises concerns about the complaint process and barriers to making a complaint against an officer. So we really tried to address that this spring with community members and city staff members on what can we do to reduce the barriers. Making a complaint against an officer is serious, but it's an important tool for management to use to check the officers, to ensure they're acting professionally and taking the right action. And also, it's feedback from the citizens. How are our officers acting out there? So we reduced some of the barriers to making a complaint. In fact, a complaint can be made by phone, a form filled out online on our website. Complaint forms can be downloaded from our website. Someone could come into the police department to make a complaint, or they could pick up a complaint form at several different locations around town. And the form is self-explanatory. There is an information sheet for how to fill out every block on the form, and that can be mailed in or dropped off at the police department.
So you've reacted to the fact that this is also a serious step for the citizen to take, and they may be reluctant to come in and do it at the front desk at the police station. You've dealt with that concern.
Right. The forms can be found online. They can be picked up in the city building, at the Boys and Girls Club, some of the churches around town. They can just walk in to the front desk of the police department and say, can I have a complaint form? And one will be handed to them, and they can walk off and mail it in later or drop it off later.
Now, after the complaint form is filed, what are the next steps?
The complaints come to my office. I review the complaints. I'm in charge of professional standards, and I try to digest what's written on the complaint form, identify the officers who are involved, identify what parties are involved, and what I'll do is I'll send the complainant a letter summarizing what their complaint is, and that letter will have my contact information on it. So a complaint may come in on a couple handwritten pages, and I try to boil down what the complaint is. I send that person a letter. This is what we understand your complaint is, and this is what we will be investigating. And they can contact me if they have a question about what I might have written in that letter. Then we begin an investigation of the incident, and the investigation may involve interviewing other people. It will certainly involve re-interviewing the officer. If we have any videotape of the incident, we'll view that, and we'll review police reports.
Now, the videotape, that's an interesting thought, because all of the cars are now equipped with cameras, so there is evidence. In some of these cases, there is evidence.
Right. In a lot of our interactions, the squad car camera is on. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's not proper for the camera to be on. Other times it is on, and the interaction can be reviewed on tape.
As your investigative process then continues, how is the complainant kept in the loop?
Sure. The complainant gets that initial letter from me with my contact information summarizing the complaint. And then they can call me at any time about the status of their complaint. If the complaint looks like it's going to be in depth and may take a serious complaint, may take more than, say, a month or a month and a half, then we'll recontact that person and tell them, based on the seriousness of this complaint, how much background work we have to do, it's taking a little bit longer. And then finally, the complaint packet and investigation is reviewed by all levels of the police department, up the chain of command, as you might say, up to the chief's level, where the chief makes a final determination on what the outcome of that complaint is going to be. When that determination is made, then the chief mails the person a letter informing them of the outcome of the investigation.
Is there, if the complainant's not satisfied, do they have a next step?
Sure. The person making a complaint gets informed from the beginning about all the step. We mail them a fact sheet. A fact sheet is available in the complaint packet about all the steps. And there is an appeal process. If the person making a complaint is not satisfied with the police department's determination, an appeal can be made to the city manager's office.
How often does a complaint rise to the scale where you have the full investigation and you go all the way through the process?
Anytime a citizen informs us that they want to file a formal complaint, we will do a full investigation. Sometimes a person will come in with a question or comment about what the officer did, and when they talk informally with the supervisor, they may be satisfied at that point, and they may decide not to file a formal complaint. But any time a citizen tells us, I want this to be a formal complaint, it will go through the entire investigative process up through the chief of police, who will make a decision.
Now, if a complaint is basically upheld, what can be some of the consequences for the officer involved?
Sure. We hold our officers accountable on complaints, and we hold our officers accountable even when something may not have come in as a complaint, when a supervisor recognizes that the officer did something wrong. The officer can receive a verbal counseling about his or her behavior. The officer can receive a written reprimand, a suspension, or could even be discharged for a very serious complaint.
Now, does the officer have recourse if he or she disagrees with the result of the investigation?
Yes, officers are bound by, and the city is bound by, a labor contract, which does talk about a grievance procedure that the officer can use if he or she receives a letter of reprimand, a suspension, or discharge.
Now, we've been talking about the complaint process, but really the process works two ways. There's also a process in place to compliment an officer or to recognize a superior performance?
Yes, actually we get more recognition and compliments from citizens than we do get complaints. We also have internal processes for giving officers commendation, but citizens can call us or send us a note or an email about good work that the officers have done on their behalf. And some examples are, you know, recovering property from a burglary, finding a lost child, that type of thing.
So the interaction with the public does indeed, by nature of the circumstances, work both ways.
Right. Sometimes the officer is the hero, and you know, or even in a tense encounter, the officer may act so professionally that the person will say, you know, this was negative for me, but we really want to compliment the officer on how professional he or she was in our interaction.
If someone chooses to come in person to the police department to make a complaint, what takes place then?
Typically what will happen is a supervisor, usually a sergeant, will be called to have a seat with the citizen and go over what the complaint is. The supervisor will give the citizen a fact sheet, which explains the complaint process, and then we'll talk to the citizen about what happened, where it happened, who was involved. And we'll ask the citizen to write out a short statement as to what they think what the officer might have done wrong in that situation and kind of give their version of the situation. So we ask them to fill out a form and affirm that their allegations are true.
And that sort of jumpstarts the process then.
Right. And then the complaint packet comes to my office. I review it and begin the process of sending the complainant a letter about summarizing their allegations.
Holly, thanks for being with us today to explain the new complaint process. The Champaign Police Department's value statement, Service with Pride, is more than just a motto. It guides their daily interactions with our community. To learn more about the police department, visit the city's website at ci.champaign.il.us/police.
The City of Champaign's CGTV, Cable Channel 5, connects you to your community. CGTV broadcasts local governmental meetings, informational and educational programming, and important announcements concerning public safety, road closures, and community events. CGTV is your source for valuable information about what's happening in Champaign. The City of Champaign's CGTV, keeping you connected.
Our guests are Dina Schumacher, fire and life safety educator with the Champaign Fire Department and their public information officer, and Renee Dunn, who's assistant to the chief for community services for the Champaign Police Department. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
We have a very special show today to honor some citizens in Champaign. Dina, tell us what the Heroes and Helping Hands program is all about.
It's very simply a wonderful opportunity for us to be able to honor people who across our city have come upon emergency situations who basically are, it's unfolding before their eyes, and they handle the situation with grace and dignity and very well.
And Renee, how are the honorees selected?
As our firefighters and our police officers arrived on the scene of some of these incidents, they encounter some heroes. They're either helping them direct traffic or they're helping them save a life. And so they nominate these citizens for these awards.
And Dina, from the fire department perspective, what are some of the kinds of things that these citizens did?
Just as you would imagine, it can be anything. This year, we had four different individuals or groups of individuals who came upon fire emergencies and needed to evacuate people, let people know, and several of them actually put the fire out before our firefighters got there. We had individuals who assisted with rescue. We had one person who actually helped someone who got down because of smoke and pulled them out of a third floor apartment and got them down and out and safe, as well as notifying a number of other people. We've also had people who just come upon situations. There was one where a gentleman had fallen out and some people stopped and helped them. So it can be anything.
And it doesn't have to be totally heroic as we might think about heroism.
It's helping hands as well as heroic, absolutely.
And Renee, what are some of the things that the police officers encountered that they thought worthy of this recognition?
We actually came upon a man that saved a woman and her child from being attacked by two vicious dogs, and he put himself in harm's way to help this family, and as a result, they didn't get injured or bitten by the dogs. We had another situation in which a neighbor noticed two unknown men attempting to enter the house as well as the car, and actually took off in the neighbor's car, and she approached them. As a result, within 1 hour, they were located, the property was recovered, the vehicle was also recovered. Another situation in which two men came upon a woman in need. Her fiancé was experiencing a seizure. They got out and assisted her and also helped to direct traffic. And that was a great help to the officers on the scene. So we have a variety of nominees as well who have done some very courageous acts.
And again, some of that is just what you as the police department would like people to do in terms of being observant.
Exactly.
Being vigilant, but then taking that next step and picking up the phone and making the call.
Exactly. And the nominees, they don't even sometimes want to be recognized. To them, it's just second nature to jump in and help. But we've seen that there are some people that just won't help and they will run from the situation. So that's one of the reasons why we want to recognize these courageous people.
Dina, we're going to show every of the honorees' names on the screen, but we don't have time to talk about every one of the incidents in detail, but could you give us an example?
Just a flavor, just a smattering of a flavor, absolutely. The most recent one happened last August. It was at the University and First Street Interchange, and it was a former fire chief from another community in a car behind a car that erupted in flames. And this fire chief and his wife stopped what they were doing, obviously, got out and rescued a woman, got her out of the car before she could be injured herself. And that doesn't always happen. People like panic and don't know what to do. So what we like to do is highlight people who are role modeling appropriate behavior. In this case, he helped, assisted, got people back, and then the firefighters came and put the fire out. Pretty simple.
And those folks who I think in both cases, they attacked dryer fires in large apartment complexes, but they knew where the fire extinguishers were. And the landlords deserve a little credit here, too, because they were where they were supposed to be and they were charged.
You are exactly right. They did several things right. They notified 911 first. Mm-hmm. That's vital. Get help on the way. And then they went back, said, I think I can handle this, got their extinguishers and put that fire out. Those, you know, there are training sessions to do that. But when people do it in real life, we want to applaud them and tell them thank you.
And Renee, you'd never encourage someone to put themselves in danger, but human nature being what it is, some people just do.
Some people just do, and that's exactly the case with one of our nominees who was driving down Mattis Avenue when he saw a teenager being bullied. And there were several young men that were grabbing him and obviously intimidating him. He turned his truck around, went to find out what was going on, asked the young man if he needed assistance. He shook his head yes, and he immediately stood in harm's way and would not let that group bother him. He was even threatened himself by the group, but he stood firm and did not leave the scene and waited until police to arrive. So that is definitely a wonderful act of heroism.
Yeah. Now, when the officers step forward and make these nominations, I know that for purposes of the recognition, they're kind of whittled down a little bit. But how do the officers, what do you learn from the officers about their interaction with these people who are not afraid to be involved?
Is that they see it as second nature. They don't understand why they're being recognized. It's to them, it's this is exactly what you should do. And the officers are going, no, everybody doesn't do that. And you are to be commended for that.
And Dina, how was the recognition handled?
It was fun and we had a wonderful time. We took time at the right before the council meeting to invite these people to come in for cookies and punch. The nominating officers came and recognized them. Our council members, our city staff came in. Their families, we had one family that flew one of the young honorees in from Colorado to be honored. So the families came. We had this time and then we went into the council meeting and our council members honored them as well with just a simple certificate and heartwarming thanks for the pieces that they did simply, like Renee said, these are humble people generally, and they don't want recognition. And we have to kind of say, come on, it'll be good. But they recognize that we want to tell them thank you, that our officers want to tell them thank you. It's kind of one of those feel-good programs that we're really proud to be able to be a part of.
Well, thanks for sharing these stories with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As you just heard, there are plenty of heroes and caring neighbors among us here in Champaign. For more information about the Heroes and Helping Hands program, check out the city's website at ci.champaign.il.us. Our guest is Stacy Rachel. She's Supervisor of Administrative Services and Public Works. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Rick. Nice to be here.
We're going to talk about parking in downtown or around the city, but the major thing that we've noticed in parking in the last year and a half is that the Hill Street parking garage opened in March of 2009. What's been the impact of that?
We've seen the interest and use of the deck grow pretty much monthly for both visitor parking as well as permit parking. Pretty much every month since the deck has opened. So it's been a slow but steady growth and gaining in popularity. And it's really become a very popular option for people when there are special events being held in the area. And so we see a lot of use of the deck at those times.
Like during the film festival, for one, I know.
Exactly.
I drive by it fairly frequently, and I seem to notice more people going in all the time. Are the merchants embracing it? Are they doing validations and that sort of thing?
Yes, we do offer a validation program for local businesses if they want to subsidize their customers' parking. And currently, we have about 16 businesses who are participating in that program. So it's gaining in popularity as well, too.
I think once people use it and get the hang of how to get in and out of it, it's a pretty easy thing to do.
Right. I think there is some initial hesitation because it's a new type of equipment. But we do have staff available in the deck from 7 a.m. to 11 p.m. Monday through Friday to help out as needed. And then also for those special events when we do anticipate a lot of people parking there, we make sure that we have staff on hand to help out to try and make it a little bit less intimidating.
Is it meeting projections or... is it too early to tell?
It's a little bit slower than we had initially projected, but there's also some other factors as far as some development projects in the area are also a little bit slower in finishing, so we're kind of dependent on some of those things in the area. One thing that has been, I think, a big success is we offer permit parking for downtown residents. And we have definitely, particularly in the last 4 months or so, seen a great increase in the number of residential permits that we've offered. So I think there was definitely a need for that the deck fills.
Come winter, that'll pick up too.
Exactly.
Now, the parking garage is only one of the downtown parking options or citywide parking options. What's a go pass?
Well, the go pass is actually available for the parking deck, and it's for someone who is a frequent visitor downtown but who may not necessarily need to get a permit, but it's a way to make it a little bit more convenient and quick for that person to get in and out of the deck. So what they do is they come to the parking office and set up an account with us and give us a credit card information that we keep on file. Then they get an access card and for their vehicle, so when they enter the deck or when they exit the deck, the gate automatically raises as they approach, so they don't have to stop, pull a ticket, and that sort of thing. And then as they leave, the amount that's due is automatically calculated by the equipment, and the charge is automatically assessed to the credit card we have on file. So it's an easy in, easy out of the deck, and just helps people get them where they need to go as easy as possible.
Sounds like it's kind of similar to the iPass on the tollway.
That's exactly, it's the very same technology, just for a different purpose.
Now, citywide, is the cash key still available to use at meters around town?
Yes, cash key is still available, and it's definitely still a very popular option for people.
Where can people pick up the cash key or purchase one or recharge theirs?
Actually, we have two locations in the city of Champaign, either in the finance department, which is located in the city building downtown, or they can come out to the parking office on Edgebrook Drive. And since the key itself actually has three accounts on it, and you can use the same key for meters at City of Champaign, City of Urbana, or University of Illinois, you can also buy a key or get time loaded at the University of Illinois parking office or the City of Urbana parking office.
So you still, to get all three, you still have to go visit all three.
Yes, unfortunately, there's not an online option like the iPass for that.
Now, you can use a credit card when you stop by to pay for it, or do you
Yes.
have to write a check?
Nope, you can pay by cash, check, credit card, whatever you prefer.
How is the pay system working out at the lot at 6th and Green, which is basically the same system, I think, that's in use at Illinois Terminal?
That's correct. Those are what's called pay-by-space, multi-space meters. And I think a great benefit, we've gotten some positive feedback, is you can use credit and debit at those machines as well as coins and cash. So it's just another way to provide additional payment options for people in case you don't have any cash on you to pay.
Any thought to expanding that system?
Well, we actually did a few months ago, installed two pay stations in the Walnut and Washington lot. That lot is for permit parking only during the day, but then at 5 o'clock it opens up for hourly parking. So we did install those pay stations in that location.
The university recently started a pilot system where they allow you to charge a few parking meters on campus by way of your cell phone. Have you had any thoughts along those lines?
Yes, we certainly investigated that option as well, but actually our first step is to look into replacing the single space meters on the street with multi-space pay stations. The thought process being it's less equipment for the office to maintain, but also provides, again, more payment options for people because those would also accept credit and debit. So before we could investigate any further into pay by cell, we need to make a decision about those multi-space meters.
There are, depending on how far you are from the core of the city, there are various combinations of rates and lengths on the meters. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you don't know how long the meter is available until you stop and get out and look. Any thoughts about putting, I know on some meters have nice big tags, mm-hmm. some don't.
Yes, definitely. We have put on those meter stickers that help to identify as you pull into a space what the time limit is, and they are color-coded as well. So blue ones are 2-hour meters, greens 10 hours. So we're trying to make it a little bit easier for people to know at least as soon as they pull in how long they can park so they don't have to move after they've already gotten to their space.
Thanks for being with us today.
Thank you so much.
Whether you're driving around town or downtown, there are plenty of places to park in Champaign. For more information on parking, visit the city's website at ci.champaign.il.us/parking. We hope you enjoyed this episode of Champaign Connection. Be sure to tune in next month for another look inside the city of Champaign. Until then, I'm Rick Atterbury. On behalf of the city of Champaign, thanks for letting us keep you connected.